COVID-19 and around specifically the reentry of schools. So we want to welcome all those participating today and hope that you find the series particularly helpful as we move forward into the fall. And also, we ask that you provide us a little bit more guidance on some of the future topics that we might consider for these series. It's also important to note that these are considerations, that Missouri is a local control state, and it's not always going to be the same in every school community. So you need to look at your school community and what's going on, working with your public health departments, and then school districts can choose the types of safety and health measures that they will be putting in place. Today's discussion topics will be focused around the reentry considerations, specifically to physical education, physical activity opportunities, whether it be recess, before and after school activities, activities during the school day, besides recess, just physical activity in the classroom, as well as sports programming. So we are really gonna be providing an overview of what's happening with COVID-19, the most up-to-date research from our guest speakers, and then how can we provide, what are some considerations that you can take to address the pandemic concerns and to ensure that students are going into an environment that's healthy and safe, not only just students, but staff as well. So our panelists today, we want to welcome Dr. Rachel Orschelin and Dr. Jason Newland. And they have been working very closely already with government, public health agencies, and other stakeholders around the state around this topic and other topics as schools begin to move forward with their plans. So we're really excited to have them today. They will provide a wealth of knowledge, and I know you're going to find their information very helpful as you move forward into the new school year. So Dr. Rachel Orschelin and Jason Newland, welcome, and thank you for being a part of this webinar today.
Thanks for having us. So I guess I'll get started here with just some background information on SARS-CoV-2. So just by way of definitions, the virus that we're talking about is severe acute respiratory syndrome coronavirus 2, or SARS-CoV-2, and that is to distinguish it from SARS-CoV-1, which was the original SARS that we saw. And this virus is fairly closely related to that virus, as well as another virus that causes a severe respiratory syndrome, the Middle East respiratory syndrome virus. In this talk and in other places, you'll hear this referred to as the novel coronavirus to distinguish it from other coronaviruses, including the more severe forms, but also the seasonal coronaviruses. We have about 4 seasonal coronaviruses that circulate in our area every year, and that's why we distinguish this one as the novel coronavirus. Now, the disease that is caused by the novel coronavirus is referred to as COVID-19. Next slide, please. So it seems like we've been dealing with this forever, at least from my perspective, but it's really only been about 7.5 months. It was really at the end of 2019 that a severe pneumonia of unknown etiology emerged in China. And really a week later, we knew the cause of this was a novel coronavirus. It was really a few months later that we saw a global health emergency being declared. And then we started to see cases emerging really all over the world. And the first case was reported in New York in March. We saw our first case shortly thereafter on March 7th. And we were fairly fortunate in Missouri in that our spring break for many schools was a short time after that. And so many schools really were naturally going to spring break. And then finally in Missouri, a stay-at-home order was issued during the middle of March, and we saw schools close permanently for the academic year on April 9th. Next slide, please. So why did we have to shut down everything? I think there has been some concern about whether that was necessary. And I can tell you from the healthcare perspective, it was certainly necessary that we really shut down and allowed for mobilization of primarily health resources. So as you may know, many of the gear that we require for use in the hospital, the personal protective equipment, is produced in China. And when that society shut down, we no longer had access to that material. We also didn't have testing capacity, and things as simple as the swabs that we use to perform the test apparently are produced in Italy. And so we really had limitations on our ability to care for patients and to test people for this infection based on limitations in supplies. And we needed also to preserve our healthcare capacity. So we really had to pull back on many procedures, different types of care, so that we could have the hospitals open and ready to care for these patients. It's really astounding. In a very short period of time, we've really advanced medical knowledge. We know research really trained its focus on this disease, and we were able to gain new information on supportive treatment strategies. And so now the way they manage patients in the ICU from the time at which they put a breathing tube in or how they position them in the ICU has really improved survival for patients in the intensive care units. And we've also gained information about antivirals that are likely to be helpful and also different anti-inflammatory treatment. We've really learned about this disease and how it progresses and what types of therapies might be most beneficial at different time points. And we have most certainly averted infections and deaths by doing some of the drastic mitigation strategies that we took upon ourselves. Next slide, please. And this is just a slide looking at hospitalizations in various locations before and after the stay-at-home order. So you can see, you know, hospitalizations climbing over time. And then really, when the stay-at-home orders go into place, we see that really flattening of the curve of those hospitalizations. And that really allowed us to preserve our healthcare capacity. Next slide, please. So, you know, one of the aspects of the community mitigation strategies was to close down schools. And I can say that I was a huge supporter of this at the time when we decided that schools needed to be closed as we were closing businesses and other community locations. And one reason we think about schools being closed as really important when you have a pandemic is that we've always been focused on influenza when we've thought about pandemic preparedness. All our previous literature on pandemic preparedness has been related to influenza. We really thought it was going to be a strain of influenza that caused this type of outbreak. And in influenza outbreaks, children are really considered the major driver of those outbreaks. If you really want to protect elderly people from influenza, you vaccinate children. We know that during pandemic influenza episodes, when you close schools, you can really affect the curve. And this is demonstrated here when you look at school closures and how that relates to cases occurring and deaths occurring in the community, you really impact those by closing schools. Next slide, please. But what we know is that influenza and the novel coronavirus are not the same. So just by way of background, we know influenza is caused by both influenza A and influenza B, and we call this the flu. It's not the same as the stomach flu where you have vomiting and diarrhea. It's, you know, really that high fever, chills. We see this occurring in our area of the country between October and November is when we usually see onset of influenza, and then it has a peak in January and February. It's transmitted in much the same way we think about the novel coronavirus, and that's through droplets that are produced when people cough, sneeze, or talk, and those are then inoculated onto the nose, mouth, or eyes of someone who's nearby. And we typically see influenza developing after an incubation period of 2 to 4 days. The symptoms overlap to a large degree with what we see in the novel coronavirus, and that includes things like fever, chills, cough, sore throat, and body aches. And like the novel coronavirus, we see vomiting, diarrhea as well with influenza in children. We see that with novel coronavirus in children. We don't typically see that in adults. Every year, somewhere between 3 and 11% of the population will develop the symptoms of influenza. But the people at highest risk are young children, and then also older adults and people with underlying medical condition. One piece of information that's gained a lot of attention and discussion is really the case fatality rate. So those people diagnosed with this infection, what percent of those die? And for seasonal influenza, it's typically around 0.1%. And that really equates to about 12,000 to 61,000 deaths from influenza every year in the United States. New slide, please. Now, the novel coronavirus, again, has a lot of similarities. We do not yet know whether this coronavirus will have a seasonal distribution. We know for the other seasonal coronaviruses, we typically see those overlapping with when we see influenza in the community. But when you have a pandemic strain, it doesn't tend to follow those normal patterns. Transmission is similar to what you see with influenza, where this is primarily a droplet. So going from me coughing or sneezing and onto your eyes or nose. I know a lot of attention has been paid to disinfecting the environment, and it is possible for the novel coronavirus. You know, if I cough directly onto a door handle, you touch that door handle, you touch your eyes, nose, or mouth, it is possible to inoculate yourself that way. But that probably represents a very small way that this is transmitted. The incubation period after exposure is somewhere between 2 and 14 days, typically on order of 4 to 5 days after an exposure. And again, the symptoms are very similar to what we see with influenza. The one kind of notable symptom that's different is this new loss of taste or smell, which seems very specific for this infection. We do not currently know what the incidence of this infection is. This has partly been hampered by our lack of availability of widespread testing. So we don't always know, even if someone is symptomatic, if this is the infection they're experiencing. But what we do know is that there are certain groups that are really high risk for this. And this really includes people over 65, very high risk for people over 85. We've really seen dramatic and devastating outbreaks that have affected long-term care facilities. And we know that some people, particularly adults with underlying conditions, can have more severe course. And that includes people with diabetes, particularly type 2 diabetes, high blood pressure, obesity, certain immunocompromising conditions, and pretty much any underlying disorder of other organ systems. The death rate, again, has been a little bit difficult to calculate because we do not know everybody who has this infection. And certainly we have come to appreciate that a large number of people are infected and have very minimal symptoms. But what we can say is probably the observed case fatality rate is somewhere between 4 and 15% in different countries. In the US, it is around 4% of people. Now, that's not the same as the infection fatality rate, which means if we could capture all the people that were infected out there but really had minimal symptoms, it'd probably be much lower, on the order of 0.6%. Now, that's still about 6 times higher than influenza, but it's certainly much lower than the 4%. Next slide, please. So when you look at this particular novel coronavirus infection in children, you see that this infection is much less common in children. If you look at data from the CDC, children make up less than 5% of cases. And so if you look at the cumulative rate per 100,000 in the population, young children less than 4 maybe are affected a little bit more often, about 9.4 cases per 100,000. When you move into the school age to teenage age group, that's 4.4 cases per 100,000. Compare that to people over 85 years of age, where there is 316 cases per 100,000. So really this disease increases in severity and symptoms with age. Next slide, please. So if you look at, some people say, well, maybe kids are really getting infected at the same rate, but we're just not picking it up. And that's potentially true to some degree. But if you look at careful studies, when there's been an exposure, children appear to be much less susceptible to this infection compared with adults with a similar exposure. So if you look at, households where there was a case, and then they looked at all the household members and tested them to see if they had been infected. In household exposures in China, about 4% of the children in the household will become infected, and that's compared to about 28% of spouses. there was a nice description of a study that occurred in related to a church event in the South, where there was a two-day church event where two people who were symptomatic attended, and then a number of people became infected after that event. And this, in this particular study, about 6.3% of children were infected, and this is despite the fact that children were doing things like going and collecting money from people, you know, having lots of interactions with the adults. This is compared to almost 60% of the adults between the ages of 19 and 64 became infected in this particular outbreak. Next slide, please. Another important feature, I think, that's specifically relevant to schools is how likely are children to transmit this to other people, because schools will be an environment where there will be lots of people, lots of children in the environment. And what we have seen is that children appear to be much less likely to transmit this infection. Children in studies throughout the world are rarely the index case or the first person in a household to become infected. It's more, much more likely that it's an adult that brings the infection home to the family. It has not yet been reported that there has been an asymptomatic child that has transmitted to other individuals in a household. Now, there are some concerns and potentially reports of asymptomatic or pre-symptomatic really adults who have transmitted to other people in certain circumstances, but this has not ever been reported from a child. And if you look at investigations of COVID-19 cases in schools, there are very few examples of secondary spread within schools. Next slide, please. So if you look at children and their risk of serious disease, this is hospitalizations by age for COVID-19. You can see the bottom two lines that really hug the baseline here are hospitalizations for children. And this is our experience in St. Louis and really across the country, is that there have been very few hospitalizations for children related to COVID-19. This compares to the age group here above 65, where you can see rates of infection are much higher. I put this little inset in here just to provide comparison with influenza, which again is likely to be a much more serious disease for children. Obviously, this is not true for adults. I've already mentioned that adults are at much higher risk for COVID-19 than for influenza. But for children, you can see that we see a number of hospitalizations every year in children, particularly younger children, but even in the 5 to 17 year age group, we see hospitalizations every year from influenza. Next slide, please. So one interesting, we've really, you know, gained new information. There's new information always emerging on this infection. And one thing that emerged was a new description of an inflammatory disorder occurring in children. And this has been referred to as the multi-system inflammatory disorder in children, or MISC-C. And I will point out that the initial description of this disorder involved 8 cases occurring in the United Kingdom and 10 cases from Italy in children. So again, if you imagine the number of people in their population that were affected with the novel coronavirus, it represented a very small number of cases. This disorder has features that are similar to other post-infectious or inflammatory disorders we see. So rarely we see a similar type of disorder that occurs with strep infections. That's called toxic shock. We can see similar features with certain viral infections causing inflammation of the heart. And then there's a pediatric disorder that happens, that we see cases of occurring every year, called Kawasaki syndrome, again, overlapping features with these disorders. In the kids who have been diagnosed with MISC-C, these most often do not have evidence of active SARS-CoV-2 infection. More commonly, we see that they either have a known exposure that occurred remotely, like a month or prior, or we find that they have antibodies to SARS-CoV-2. So they don't really have active infection. So this appears to be a post-infectious phenomenon. It is a serious disorder. I can say that about 80% of the cases have required care in the intensive care unit. But fortunately, despite the serious nature of this disorder, most children have recovered fully, and there have been very few deaths reported, even with this most serious manifestation. So if you look at coronavirus mortality by age, you can see that we, you know, in this bottom line is the children, actually 0 to 24. I guess we're considering 24-year-old children now. So again, very few deaths have been reported in that age group. the most deaths, obviously, in the over 85 age group. And so this is the weeks over time. So we really have seen this decline in deaths over time for all groups, which is one of the reasons why we feel comfortable moving forward with opening up some parts of our society. Just by way of comparison again, in the US, when I looked last, which was on July 4th, there had been 29 pediatric deaths in the United States from COVID-19 as of the time period. By comparison, there were 185 pediatric deaths in the last flu season. Next slide, please. So I think an important question is, we do not know exactly how long we are going to be dealing with the novel coronavirus. And so we start to think about how can we resume some of the normal activities that are important for our society. And one of those really critical things is getting back to school in the fall. Next slide, please. So, you know, one of the really key features of getting back to school will be having a procedure in place to ensure that we protect everybody in the environment. And one of the most important things will be making sure that nobody comes to school with any symptoms that could be referable to the novel coronavirus. So, you know, these include symptoms that are familiar to us and represent symptoms that could be seen in a variety of different disorders, including normal infections of childhood, fever and chills, cough, now shortness of breath, hopefully wouldn't be something you'd be coming to school with, but fatigue, muscle aches. Again, really the symptom that's just really specific is this new loss of taste or smell. But you know, we know sore throat, congestion, runny nose, these are common findings. And so we're really going to have to be very vigilant about making sure that no person comes to school with any of these symptoms. One particular thing we really need to assess for is if anyone has exposure to a person with a positive test for SARS-CoV-2. What I've mentioned previously is that it is very unlikely that a child would be the first person in their family to be diagnosed with this infection. So by making sure that we don't have children come to school who have a family member who's been diagnosed, we can dramatically reduce the chances that a child will be coming to school with this infection and not know that they have it. Next slide, please. So, you know, we're going to have to put some strategies in place that help to prevent spread if someone comes to school. Obviously, we want to make sure that everybody is practicing good respiratory etiquette, not coughing into their hands and touching the doorknobs. We want to have frequent hand hygiene more so than we have previously in schools. We know that in general, using frequent hand hygiene is associated with a reduction in respiratory illnesses. And we want to make sure that people don't transmit any infection in the school, because that will result in the need to be excluded for a period of time while a student is being assessed for whether they could have infection with the novel coronavirus. We also want to make sure we have full vaccination for influenza. I think I've previously mentioned that there's a lot of overlap between influenza and COVID-19. And so we can help to avoid the need for people to be excluded and to have additional testing for COVID-19 if we can protect them against influenza. We will be doing some, or need to be doing some enhanced environmental cleaning, and that will mostly be focused on high touch surfaces or shared equipment. Next slide, please. Another strategy that will be useful and will be really important for the adults in the environment is masks. Okay, so masks and physical distancing have been credited with reducing the spread of the novel coronavirus in communities. And this is particularly important for adults, who are the people who primarily spread this infection. And when we have seen transmissions occur in schools or in hospitals, it often involves co-workers infecting one another rather than, let's say, patient to healthcare worker or student to teacher. So it's, you know, we have our masks on when we are facing the patients, but if we take our masks off when we're sitting in the break room, that's really a way that people can become infected. We do know that for very young children, continuous face mask usage may be difficult, but we also know that those children are at much lower risk of transmitting this infection. Next slide, please. So another strategy that's really important is physical distancing. And this is important for a couple of reasons. One, it actually reduces the chances that if I have anything in my respiratory droplet, it will transmit to another person. There's been a lot of discussion about what the most appropriate distance is for physical distancing. Some people say 3 feet, some people say 6 feet. we know that 3 feet is probably sufficient for and really approaches 6 feet in terms of protection against transmission. But there are probably circumstances where even larger distances might be necessary. So one thing in particular that's been demonstrated to spread infection is talking loudly, shouting, singing. And so we have to think about, especially if we get into our older age groups, about mitigation strategies for those students. Next slide, please. Another strategy that can be important is really cohorting students, because one of our overarching principles is that we want to really reduce the total number of contacts that anybody has in a day. If we reduce the number of contacts, we just reduce the likelihood that any person would come in contact with someone who was incubating this infection. And so if we can keep our students in small groups, we just reduce their total number of contacts. And this is probably particularly important for young children, where it's really not going to be feasible to totally physically distance kindergartners all the time. But since we understand that those children are at lower risk of acquiring and transmitting this infection, and they can probably easily be cohorted and kept together in their group, then we're less worried about the physical distancing, and we hopefully won't drive ourselves crazy with that. Next slide, please. So one, I think I've talked about the fact that obviously we want people not to get infected with this, the novel coronavirus. And I think I've emphasized that children are very low risk for acquiring and transmitting this infection. Obviously, adults are at higher risk of acquiring and transmitting this infection, but we can do strategies with adults like using face masks, using physical distancing to reduce those chances. So what are the other reasons, one of the most important reasons why we need to adhere to some of these strategies, specifically the distancing and the cohorting, is because of the need to do contact tracing. So contact tracing refers to the process by which we identify contacts of someone who has COVID-19. And the reason why we want to do this is we want to detect infections early and prevent those people from transmitting to other people unknowingly. And we do this through the use of quarantine. And what we will need to do is identify, you know, if we have a case in school of a teacher or a student, we need to identify those students or other people who are around that person within 6 feet for greater than 15 minutes, and those people will be considered close contacts. If a person is identified as a close contact, they will need to be excluded from school for 14 days. So by doing our various mitigation strategies, we can reduce the chances that we will need to exclude large groups of students for long periods of time from school. Next slide, please. So this is an outbreak example, or it's not an outbreak, actually, a description of cases of COVID-19 that occurred in a school in Australia. And one of the things Jason and I have been looking at carefully, and many people have been looking at carefully, is the experience of schools opening up in different countries, because I think we can gain a lot of information from that about risk to students or risk to staff in those circumstances. And in this particular outbreak investigation, or not outbreak, I'm sorry, we had cases occurring in various locations. And you can see that there were, in this particular survey, there were 735 students who were identified as close contacts to these 9 students and 9 faculty, as well as 128 staff. And what they did in follow-up for these close contacts was they screen them carefully for symptoms. They actually did nasal swabs. We may not always have access to doing this in the United States, but they did nasal swabs at 5 and 10 days looking for active virus. And they also did serologies, which is looking at the antibody response to infection. And what they noted in this was that there was only one primary school student who developed a positive swab and an antibody. And there was one high school student that developed an antibody, demonstrating that they had the infection at some time in the past. But you can see the large number of people that had to be excluded based on these students or staff coming to work with this infection. So although there were very few secondary transmissions, lots of people had their education or work situation impacted by people being at school with this particular infection. Next slide, please. So I will transition at this point to physical education. And so we really know that physical, as pediatricians, we know, and you know, that physical activity is very important to a child's physical and emotional well-being. And we know that the time of stay-at-home orders, I can speak for my own children, has resulted in increased sedentary behavior and probably decreased fitness. Next slide, please. So when we think about our physical activity, we want to think about both contact and transmission risk. And when we think about how to organize physical activity, we want to think about what activities are lower risk. And I think I've talked about this, well, I didn't speak about outside, but generally outside activities are felt to be lower risk, smaller groups or cohorts, using individual equipment, and also non-contact activities. No activity is going to be specifically excluded, but we just want to think about the risk again as we plan our activities. And I think with the next slide, I'll transition to Dr. Newland.
Good morning, everybody, and thank you for attending. And I've already seen a lot of great questions in the chat box, which I think it reflects some of the concerns that many people that we're hearing about for you all going back into the classroom around physical education. Here, the first slide, I just want to talk about what are some of our guiding principles in thinking this through. And again, it's to maximize safety for all, and especially you as the educators, because without you, education doesn't happen. So we have to be making sure that you all are feeling safe so that our children and teenagers can be to have this important part of their school experience. So one, children need activity. Two, you all need to be safe. Three, we need to maximally use of social distance activities. Can we be innovative in regards to how we use spaces? Making sure, can we use the outside as much as possible, maximize ventilation as we can? Can we take this opportunity to really enforce and re-engage in the importance of hand hygiene before and after these activities with hand sanitizer or soap and water? And I've seen some really good posts on social media and such about, well, how do you do that if you have 25 little ones coming into a space? How do we do that? And this is where I think utilizing the hand hygiene and maybe doing it as part of one of the exercises to begin PE, where every one of them gets a glob of alcohol sanitizer, then we all go through the process of wiping all surfaces, including in between the fingers, don't forget your thumbs, and making sure it's all dry as one of our physical education activities before and after we build that in. I mean, you guys are innovators already. And so doing that will, I think, be helpful. I think limiting congregation, especially, I feel like these high schoolers potentially in locker rooms, and how do we stagger the use of those in ways that can work? Now, mind you, Rachel talked about the masking and how important masks are. I think tomorrow there'll be a publication come out from the CDC. For many of you maybe in the Springfield area know of the story of the hairdressers where none of the clients got ill while one was cutting hair with the others. I think you'll learn that this is a really important strategy, at least for people on transmission. So I think that should be another important piece. Limiting the shared equipment. As Rachel mentioned, I think, this disease or this virus is primarily spread by people. This is a person-to-person thing. Now, again, as she stated, right, you cough all over something, you put all your secretions onto something, and then someone picks it up and touches it in your mouth. That can't happen. So enhancing our cleanliness will be super important. But again, the primary mode is going to be person-to-person. So, throwing a ball, throwing the baseball back and forth, we don't have to clean it after every time we touch it. That's not going to be where that risk is. No one's coughing it. And I'd like to, if we really change our culture as a society where we're not going to work sick, we're not having our kids go to school sick, that's going to help us. Now, that is challenging in so many ways because of so many other social pressures, but that needs to be a part of this. And so these are some initial thoughts. Oh, next slide, please. Sorry, I forgot you're changing them. I would recommend strongly for teacher safety that mask or facials at all times when teaching. I think that the data is coming out and we're learning more that the child transmission to the adults. And there is an age gradation of this. So that 18-year-old teenager is probably a little bit more like a lot more like an adult than the 7-year-old child. So these matter, but I think the greatest risk for you all is likely going to be in your home environment and when you're kind of in a time where you're not in front of the kids. Because in front of the kids, we're all going to be kind of on edge. Just like for me at work, I'm a lot more on edge when I'm walking in the hospital going to take care of a patient than I am when I'm sitting back going to talk to my colleagues and potentially having a meeting. But those are the cases where we're seeing more transmission, is that it's in the break time. So this idea of wearing a mask all the time throughout is going to be super important. I think social distance from students, being masked will significantly reduce any possible transmission from the children, but it does appear asymptomatic transmission overall is rare in adults. And as Rachel mentioned, it also seems to be, we haven't any reports of, say, symptomatic children. So if we're screening and we're buying into that, it should reduce that risk as well. So we have asymptomatic kids in our school, we're practicing social distancing, and then we add on top of that the mask and the impact of the mask, we should be safe. We should continue to be safe. And I think the prevailing literature continues to show that it's safe. And then lastly, hand hygiene. You guys are already doing this. This is what your daily routines are, because you've been doing physical education and know about all the dirtiness that occurs with doing this and the sweating and stuff. So I think that has to be continued, and now we just do it better. Next slide. So again, disinfecting equipment. This seems like a challenge, and I look forward to learning as you all get into doing this, and you probably already thought about this. There are numerous products available. One has told me, like, look, this virus is kind of a wimp in the sense that most disinfectants are going to inactivate the virus. I've also had the question come up a couple of times, well, what if we don't have any of these disinfectants? Is there anything else you can do? Well, the CDC lists out, you know, diluted household bleach is also effective. Here's the recipes: at 5 tablespoons per gallon of room temperature water, or 4 teaspoons per quart of water. Put it on the surface, let it sit for a minute. It'll work. I recommend wearing gloves when handling these disinfectants, just for your own sake, but don't think the gloves are complete protection. After you remove the gloves, make sure you wash your hands, because again, if you picked up the virus on the glove and then you take it off, you now touch your hands. So make sure you're washing your hands. And again, I think wiping down the balls and these things that have shared equipment between groups. So you have one activity maybe for that hour, and one might say, well, how do I do that quickly if I have another group coming in? And if you have 2 sets, maybe that allows for something, and building in some time will be important. And these are strategies, I think, working together, and how you might do that is important. Next slide, please. I think for the students, for these people coming in, I think for most of them, I think these older children, masks can be worn coming in and leaving from PPE. I think during the activities, not wearing the mask makes the most sense, and working on the social distancing. Again, stressing this notion of, okay, I have an asymptomatic person. They should not have any symptoms. We're screening everybody. They should be healthy. We've gone through that screening. Now they're here at school. I know they're well. So having the mask at this point is probably unnecessary. I, as the teacher, am in the mask. I'm going to do some social distance as I do teach. Now, of course, some are saying, well, what if I don't have the space, right? How if I don't have the space? Well, again, the mask should give us a lot of protection in that scenario still. I wouldn't have them wear the mask during the activity unless there are certain activities you think are, you know, not as strenuous. And again, use the social distance as much as you can as we do this. Next slide, please. So that's what I think on physical education. I'm not going to go near as long, because I think Rachel really covers kind of the nuts and bolts of this, but I want to get into sports, and we can obviously, I know I already see there's 12 questions in the chat box, so we'll have a lot of time. I want to give a lot of time for questions. You know, there's no doubt a differential risk based on the level of contact and based on the environment, right? Like Rachel demonstrated, indoor versus outdoor matters. There's a study out of China that showed, of many different cluster outbreaks, there was only one that occurred outdoors. However, I'm not one to say, let's get, you know, a couple thousand people into an outdoor stadium. I think that is bringing up the risk, but likely goes down with you bring them in and you put a lot of masks on. But still, that's not ideal. So here are the lists of high frequency contact with groups. This is a list that was developed by a task force that included pediatric sports medicine doctors, orthopedics, athletic trainers, pediatric infectious diseases. And you can see kind of these low frequency of contact sports, diving, gymnastics, things that you're away from people and you can and do those things. Next slide, please. So again, health screening, as Rachel mentioned, is essential for sports. Prior to school should be adequate, though I think there are concerns by some that says, well, could we potentially do this prior to them now coming together in, you know, for the sports? And I think if we can do another level of screening, that could work. However, if it's going to mean you're screening 500 kids and they're all lined up waiting to do this, I think that kind of defeats the purpose in many cases, because now we're doing is promoting some congregation. I believe staggering the use of locker rooms to maintain distancing will be challenging but important. We use the social distancing and we create practice cohorts as we go through this for high contact sports, really to decrease sizes of groups. So if you do hear about, you know, I had a case in this group, I'm not going to lose the whole team due to quarantining. So the example we've heard as well is like for the football team, you don't put all three or four or five quarterbacks together because one quarterback gets sick, you no longer have a quarterback on the team. And maybe that's also basketball guards. I mean, you guys know these different sports, the way that can be. Next slide. Now I wouldn't share equipment. There's no time. I mean, I put this water bottle holder, like these, the era of the, you know, the kid running out, the manager or someone running out with the water bottle and everyone grabs one. That's not where we are right now. I think, you know, using things like jerseys and, you know, the, or whatever uniforms that are being worn, I would have those laundered daily. I think that can be a challenge for, you know, in some areas and for others. I know even in my own house, that's a challenge and we're going to have to work on to do that better. I think we disinfect, like we suggested with PE. I think for a weight room, for example, this is a perfect opportunity to really get the athletes to be disinfecting and wiping things down after each use. I think in the white weight room, they could be wearing a mask in between going to their different exercises to do that, because, you know, maybe they're not able to distance as well, but during the time of that, they can. Or if you're having a spotter for lifting, then that person's in a mask, but the other person's not. These things, I think, will help and limit any transmissions that's occurring, even in that, in the older age group and the teenagers. I think you got to limit the spectators, and we don't need any unnecessary personnel. The era where the parents are coming to watch their kids at practice really needs to end during this time. I know as a crazy sports parent, I always love to go watch my kids practice, but this isn't the time for that. Any extra personnel just makes it potentially for some getting together, or maybe somebody that could potentially have the virus at that time, especially an adult who might be pre-symptomatic. Having lists of your people, of your sports teams, and knowing who is there and who isn't there and why. I mean, I think for the schools, that's going to be something I think is going to be important for them, because why was somebody absent and how that might impact the other groups, because we're going to have to do contact tracing. And as much as I like to tell you all that our health departments have the resources and the ability to contact trace every positive, we are learning that that's quite difficult. And probably the safest thing is for us to be aware of who the contacts are and who potentially needs to be excluded due to being a contact. Next slide. So I think another piece of this for your athletes, because you all know that you're going to have athletes and kids have COVID-19. You probably already know some. There's probably some of your athletes and some of the kids you're going to teach have had that. And there are some potential heart involvement concerns that have been published by the American Heart Association. And our local pediatric cardiologist that's working with our task force, as well as a guy in conjunction with the AHA, suggests we should keep kids out of physical activity for 2 weeks after having COVID-19. We don't know this data, what this is going to mean. Part of this is just to say, let's make sure we have a rest and let, if there was any heart symptoms, that we know about them, and that there should be kind of a reassessment and basically the, you know, making sure we bring them back to the activity in a smart graded fashion, not just throw them right back into maybe that 5K cross country meet soon after. These sorts of things will be important and to continue to monitor. This, as you know, and as you guys are experiencing, and probably very frustrating how things are evolving quickly. Every day there's something new that we're learning. This is another factor we will learn as we move forward. Next slide. So here are my closing thoughts, and then I look forward to answering all these great questions. I think we have to entrust and have the belief from everybody that our teachers, coaches, athletic trainers will be safe with students who participate in physical education and sports. I believe you will be. I believe that with mass distancing, health screening in the environment, with these mitigation strategies, as well as with some of our understanding of the virus, that we will learn that can be safe. There are some risks, obviously, but I think there's these things that I think the benefits of this will outweigh these risks. Additionally, hand hygiene and disinfecting will be important, but not near as important as this masking, distancing, health screening, and knowing when you're sick. I think our biggest threats to sports will likely be the activities occurring outside the classroom, practices, and games. Our break rooms without masks, our high school parties, our kids being in these big other congregate settings at parties and things where there are illnesses that occur that likely will lead to the transmission. And I believe, and obviously you all are part of this, and this has been your careers, is about that this is important for these kids. And how do we do that I think will be a challenge. And I believe we can rise to this challenge. Now, with all this being said, if we continue to see increases in cases, as we are, this becomes less and less able to be done. And those conversations will be difficult, though. We really believe that we can get there as long as we can kind of work together here on out. So with that, I'm happy to start, you know, tackling the so far 21 questions that we have in here.
Yeah, real quick. One of the ones that came up is, will this be available? Will the replay be available? And the slides for this recording. I think we covered that in the beginning.
Yes.
Yes, yes. So for everybody who asked that question, yes, the replay will be available to those who registered.
Yeah, we'll drop a link into the chat at the end, and you'll have access to the recording, to a PDF of the slide deck with all the information and contact information as well.
All right, this is Dion. I've seen a couple of questions that have to do with just that idea that, yes, we want students back in school, but we want them back in school safely. So the question was, how often are children actually tested for COVID? If they're not symptomatic, are they not being tested? And what does that mean for us?
I can take that question. So, you know, I think one of the concerns has been, are children really asymptomatically infected at a large degree, and that will bring them to school with this particular infection. So what I would say about that is that we know that children, again, are rarely the first person in their family, especially for young children, to be infected with this. And so it's unlikely that children will, without any contacts, you know, have this particular infection. The second point is that there have been population surveys that have looked in various locations, communities where there has been transmission of this virus, and, you know, sampled either kids or adults, both by nasal swab or antibody. And we consistently find that children are much less likely to be represented in cases. And so we think it is unlikely that children, you know, certainly they can be asymptomatically infected, and they often are when they're known to be contacts of a case, that they often are asymptomatic, but they're rarely going to be the first person in their family. And they do overall seem to be infected at a much lower rate when they are exposed to someone who is a case and then tested for that purpose.
So here's another question that is coming up. Clearly we want kids back in school, but we also recognize there needs to be a culture change. And we know that some students are gonna come to school either symptomatic, or they're going to become sick during the day. So is it a recommendation that they should be wearing masks all day long? What are the recommendations would you be making for the schools?
So that's a great question. So I think, you know, the screening strategy has a number of arms to it. One is the arm where we're asking parents to screen their children at
Rachel,
home.
Rachel, you're muted.
Oh, she's now muted.
Still muted.
She's muted now.
Can you hear me now? Is it? Okay. Sorry. The screening strategy has a number of arms to it, where we expect the parents to screen the children at home for symptoms. Can you hear me now? Okay. We expect the parents to screen the children at home for symptoms. And then when the children come to school, it's going to be the
We're trying to figure out Rachel's mute. Jason, could you
join I have me? Rachel. I can hear Rachel fine.
Yeah, I could too.
I cannot. Is your back? Is it
physical? You can keep going, Rachel.
Okay, so we're expecting parents to screen at home. We're expecting then the second layer is really that, you know, if a child, you know, has any symptoms, you know, cough, runny nose, they will be sent home. So a parent can try to send a child to school with symptoms, but really the most important symptoms in terms of transmission, well, actually probably the most important symptom is really cough. And so it's hard to suppress a cough. And so if a child has a cough, then they will need to be sent home. Now we know that children will develop symptoms at school occasionally. And so we'd need to have masks available if we're not routinely masking kids, but all children should have a mask with them at school. I've suggested they can keep it in a pencil case, you know, when they are using it and not using it. And that mask should be available to be put on. Additionally, the school should have a supply of masks for anybody who's symptomatic. And then the age at which and the time at which we ask children to wear masks will depend to some degree on community transmission. So, you know, in St. Louis, we're probably going to have kids wear masks from third grade up most of the time during the day, especially when they're not physically distanced. Now, that might not be necessary in every location in Missouri. I'm from a small town in mid-Missouri, and if there are no cases occurring in that location, maybe mask usage all the time isn't necessary. I do think students need to be taught to wear masks. They need to have masks available to them. And if there's any transmission in the community, especially junior high and high school, probably need to wear masks most of the time.
Yeah, I would just say-
This is a related, go ahead.
Sorry. I was just gonna say, I'll just add, I think the masking, as Rachel said, is super important and how we do that and really training our kids how to do that based on where the transmission is. And, you know, I was walking through the grocery store yesterday and there was little 6-year-olds like just wearing their mask, supporting them with their mom. And, you know, I do think that they're going to have a harder time going a long time a day. So how do we create innovative times, even for the teenager? What are innovative times that they can have mask free time, right? And where is that, right? I don't want, you know, mask free time with 10 of them deciding that we're having mask free time, because that's what that's not what we're talking here. So I think these sorts of things we're going to learn, and hopefully we're going to be sharing those so other people can do that.
Sorry. So Jason, you were talking about
this
masks,
is a related question about masks. Beyond
here.
So when kids take their masks off, what should they be doing with their masks? And then how should those masks be cleaned, and who's going to be responsible for that?
Well, the masks, you know, they should have a place to put the masks. Again, I've suggested they have a pencil case or something that where they put the mask where it can be kept clean. We don't want them sharing the mask, so we want the masks labeled with their names. And then they should be cleaned regularly by their parents at home.
Yeah, going back to Jason, which when you were talking about mask and physical education, can we kind of go back on that and how they're supposed to be using physical education, if they're supposed to be using physical education, and then also playground equipment in recess?
Yeah, Sean, thank you. Yeah, I was trying to type in some answers too for that so people can see. So on the masking, I think this notion of, as Rachel said, I mean, some of the younger kids, it's not going to be there as much, but the older kids, I think you're showing up with your mask on, you're kind of having to decide, okay, what are our activities today? You know, if we're running, exerting ourselves, the mask isn't going to be there. And how do we do that from a social distance manner? I think where do you put that? As Rachel said, you know, different holders with their name on it. I think we've also talked about, you know, what do you touch? Don't just go grab it with your face and, you know, throw it down and it ends somewhere like that. You know, you're dirtying up, you know, making that mass not clean like you wanted. And so that'll be important. I think for the playground equipment, I want to go back to this. Like, we could get really, really crazy, right? And we could have someone just standing next to the playground equipment. As soon as somebody jumps off it, we're going to wipe it down really fast. Well, I don't think that's what we have to do. I think we can be smart about it. We can be practical about it. So if you have the resources after each resource, someone recess, somebody is going to go and wipe it down. Okay. I actually think you could probably do it in the middle of the day and at the end of the day, and it's going to be ready for the next day. Because I think the transmission is likely more to occur, and I think it's going to be rare between children. It's going to occur when they're all together clumped on it and wrestling on it. I mean, if we can use the playground equipment in a way that, okay, two people are on it, they're kind of apart, that makes a lot more sense. And that's, you know, that's a better way. And I think you're not going to get the transmission off the playground equipment. I actually get a little annoyed that they shut down a lot of the playgrounds. I said, look, if we can just be smart and keep people away, that's a better way. But of course, you open the playground, like 100 people around you, said, well, okay, maybe you have to close it. So that's kind of where my take is.
We also had a suggestion from Christy Lee that some people are clipping their mask to a lanyard around their neck. So there is a repeated question here about legal ramifications if a staff member becomes ill, perhaps actually dies. My guess is that's not a question that you guys would be answering. I think that's a question for their district's lawyer. Is there anything that you'd want to add to that?
Well, I would say that, you know, we know there are ways people can protect themselves from becoming infected, and that includes wearing face masks and staying home when you're personally sick. I think, you know, schools are generally protected against legal action related to COVID-19, but obviously schools want to do the right thing by their staff as well.
Laura, do you want to add anything to that?
I totally agree. I think as long as, I don't think there is going to be grant a play and your school health and measures in place, you have tried to address all aspects of it. And so I agree with Rachel on her comment.
There's a question here. I think it's a great idea. Can a FAQ sheet be developed specific to, I guess that's high school PE teachers?
We are going to do an FAQ.
There will be one. Like, that's what I'm hearing. In the room.
Yes. We are working on that. We actually are taking these FAQs and we are, ensuring that we are going to try to address them, and we're lucky to have Rachel and Jason here to address them as we move forward, so that we can, and then we will post them on a web page, mohealthyschools.com, as well as put it on our Twitter accounts, which you'll see in another slide. So people will have access to the most recent information and FAQs for every.
So back to physical education again, we had somebody who mentioned about college age students, you know, that age range, or what's their possibility of, you know, getting the infection. Then also class sizes within your public schools and physical education class.
Probably, you know, college age students, again, the risk is a gradient over time in terms of their risk of acquiring the infection. And also college age students are more likely to engage in social activities that may put them at risk. We've seen locally recently and in our state, you know, the rise in cases recently has really been in this age group of the young adults. And so we know they're a group at risk. And so I do think they need to be managed more like adults in terms of usage of face masks. They're more likely to be able to comply with that type of activity. And then to the second point, class sizes. I think the nice thing about physical education is that much of it can be done in large areas. And so either that's the outside area or in gymnasiums where people, even in a large class, can be physically distanced. And so I think that's one of the real advantages of physical activity, is that it can be distanced in large areas.
And one of the things I would like to piggyback on that is that a lot of school districts are looking at cohorting children. You saw that in the slides that were in the slide deck. So keeping those cohorts of children together as they move into physical education or out to the playground or after school activities, keeping those cohorts of students together, again, will help with that contact, limiting contact to cases. So I think utilizing that practice throughout the school day is very important.
We have several questions about disinfecting materials. Just, you know, what can be used? Where are we going to find them? So what is the best idea if you cannot buy Lysol disinfectant type disinfectant at the Walmarts?
Yeah. So I think that, you know, the one big concern is what kind of surfaces are we talking about, right? So I think people are like, well, early on in the pandemic, it's like, well, I have my couch and someone was sitting on my couch. What do I do about cleaning my couch? You're not going to get the virus off the couch. I mean, it's going to be next to, I think you're going to do routine cleaning and you're going to be okay with the couch. Now, hard surfaces, as Rachel mentioned earlier, if someone's hacking or coughing all over, you know, a hard surface, that's a whole different scenario, right? Like that's the surface you want to kind of make sure you cleaned up. That, you know, these harder surfaces. And so it's a real challenge. I understand. I saw that, you know, one post says, look, we can't get this stuff. How am I supposed to get my Lysol? How am I supposed to, you know, get these other approved things? Well, number one, we have to keep work. Our school districts and stuff are going to have to work together to figure out what are those things. Number two, I put up the bleach example because you can usually get household bleach. Like household bleach, I feel like you still can kind of find and use that to wipe these down. Now, it's not the ideal. Don't get me wrong. It'd be awesome if we all had the sanitation wipes that we know have the CDC approval. And mind you, if you go to that link that we have in the slides about all the CDC recommended through the EPA, it's like tons of pages. It's like so much. You're like, are you kidding me? Like, it almost seems like everything that you could potentially buy as a disinfectant will work. The question is, can you find it? And so what my point being is that there are things out there. Think about the hard surfaces. Don't get caught up with the rug or some of these other things. You know, a wrestling mat, okay. I mean, we're all not super big fans of wrestling. Sorry to your wrestlers out there, right? But wrestling obviously makes us nervous. And that mat, I'd be wiping down the mat, just like the weightlifting equipment. I'd be wiping down my weightlifting equipment because that you can do. It's hard surfaces and it's easy. So I don't know. I hope that helps. I don't think it gives you quite the answer I think we all would love, that I say, okay, here's the product. You can definitely find it. You can definitely buy it and you'll definitely have it. That's just not how it works in the day of COVID-19, right? Like we don't even have that for testing. And so obviously we can get into that, but that's some of the challenges for sure. Some of you guys will come up with really innovative stuff that we should definitely share.
Well, and I think it's important to note is that your school facilities, people have already put together some of these plans with your cleaning and disinfecting. So I think if you go to your school facilities, they will also have some products already purchased and in place. And Rachel, I think you were going to say something.
Well, I would say, you know, just to circle back around to what Jason said before, that really, you know, it's respiratory droplet that's the most important. And then we're going to put the additional layer of having kids do hand hygiene before they are using shared objects. And so then that's going to dramatically, again, reduce the chances there'll be any virus on any surface. And then we're going to clean them. But I think, again, the contribution of objects to transmission is very low. And so, you know, accessing the cleaning products that are provided by the school is going to be necessary. And we're going to want to routinely clean things to prevent transmission of other infections. But I think by our enhanced use of hand hygiene, really at a minimum, we're going to dramatically reduce the chances that anything is going to be contaminated with this virus.
Yeah, I have another question. And this one, I think that a lot of these are practical questions that people are trying to figure out. And that's one of the reasons we were asking you if you are willing to share your name, if you have a plan, and if there's some pieces that you're putting in place that you'll have a chance to talk to each other. But one of them is that students are going to need to bring water bottles to keep hydrated. Has there been any ideas about how these bottles will be refilled throughout the day? So that's a very practical question.
Yeah, I mean, I think, and I'll, Rachel can talk to, what I believe is that I don't worry about the water fountain. Now, you might shut down the water fountain because it's going to congregate, but you know, what we have talked about in a lot of schools is, can you have the water filler stations at least open for those, right? Because then you can do that. I mean, people worry about putting their mouths on it. Fine, shut down that piece of the water fountain, but get water filler stations that they can just put that under there. That would be great, right? The key is congregation. And if you have a system where you can say, okay, you guys, we're going to do a couple go 6 feet apart, you can do that. You're in your mask, you're washing your hands, we're doing these things. I think that's safe. So yeah, I think the water bottle is important. We shouldn't shut down all water fountains just because. I think you can have the water fill water stations for sure. And let's remember, it's the congregation and spread by people to people more than it is going to be from touching the water fountain.
Sean, do you see any other questions that you think we really need to address now?
I think there was one, a few on equipment usage and sharing of equipment. I know we might have talked about that, but, you know, kind of cover equipment usage and physical education. And then do we make, or, you know, can we make students part of the process of cleaning?
Mm. Yeah, I like the students a part of the cleaning. I like that if you can build them into the process. Now, you don't want to obviously have a lot of downtime or, you know, waste a lot of time. I think that's some of these notions about a lot of these things, right? It's like you're balancing the, okay, we need the cleanliness, we need to get the activities. How do you do that? But you, like, you can build in the hand hygiene. You can build in maybe that end of time. We're going to take an extra 5 minutes and we're going to wipe down our surfaces. We're going to wash our hands, and we're going to go, maybe for the older kids, we're going to go get our mask. We're going to put our mask on. And someone was asking, well, does that mean they need to carry a container to put their mask in? Well, maybe you have containers that then they have their mask in, they get their mask on, and then they wipe down that container to get it ready for the next person that they can put their mask in. You know, these are things that they could potentially do that we can be innovative about. I mean, we have done that in our own hospital setting where we have to put on face shields for certain things. And each of us would have a face shield. It would be hanging. We would wash it. We would be back. And then somebody else would come and we would, you know, like these things, we share things in the hospital. And we wipe them down. I mean, I just put on a face shield the other day, and it's not my face shield, right? So I wipe those down, and we have containers. So I think that's the stuff we can do and build our kids into that process.
Yeah, I would say for the use of disinfectants, though, the instructions on those have to be observed carefully. Some do require you wear gloves for those. And so depending on the type of disinfectant, we have to be cautious about that. I would want to follow up on one point Jason said as well about face shields. I know, some, people have concerns about being back in the classroom. That's another strategy that we can use. It's Jason and I, here's me today in as I'm seeing patients in the hospital, so you can use these strategies, and we know that these are a way, Jason and I see only sick people, and we know that these are ways we can protect ourselves. So another strategy that schools can use is to have these sort of equipment available depending on the level of transmission in your community. Again, if you're in an area with very low community transmission, a few cases, these things might not be necessary. But if you're a higher risk individual or in an area where there's a lot of community transmission, another layer of protection for you is to add a face shield on top of your mask.
All right, Emily, did you want to ask the question about PPE moving indoors?
Sure, there's just been a few questions regarding what happens when PE needs to move indoors during the cold months, or in scenarios where districts make the decision that PE is going to happen in the classroom.
Yeah, I mean, I think these are these challenges that, you know, what do you do next? How do we do this? Now, I'll be honest, I don't know the state requirements and the things that you must do with PE, and so that's on me for not quite understanding that as I answer this question. I think we're going to have to, you know, I'd like to tell you that when we get to the cold months, we're not going to be dealing with COVID-19, but yeah, everyone's shaking their head and go, you're nuts. I'm like, yes, I know. It's not, we're still going to be dealing with this when the cold months hit, unfortunately. I think that we just have to be prepared for that. So how do you use the space in a classroom? Yes, some of you say, look, we barely have 3 feet now. We have a cohort, right? Some of this cohort aren't going to be in mask. We are going to have screened them. I do understand that, like, not everyone can assume they're going to be there, but hopefully we're speaking up if we have a child there that is coughing and ill and they're not going to be there. We have rest assured that we're comfortable that they're not sick. And so maybe you use the cohort design and you're going to say, okay, I got 4 or 5 that are going to do this in one part of the room, another 4 or 5 in this part of the room for the younger age. The older age group, I think it gets way more challenging, right? And what are those activities going to be? And I think then, as we have to move PE indoors, is how can we work with our schools to repurpose space, right? So I saw a question in the box. Okay, we have a PE class and there's three in the high school and there are 3 of them in the gym. Okay, well, you have your cohorts. Maybe you're going to do more activities that are going to be just mask-based because they're the older kids and we feel like we're going to do mask-based things or face covering-based activities, whatever those can be that you can do. And that's what we're going to have to do. This is going to take your guys' wits and smarts in understanding the virus. That's why I love what Rachel presents to say, okay, we know how this virus spreads. We know that. We put this in place. So now I'm going to do this and I can't have the distancing I like for my teenager. So I'm going to keep them in mask and we're going to do the following. And we'll learn and then share that. And how do we do that? And I can imagine that can be obviously unnerving. But I think we can do it and we can do it well. And I saw a question in the chat about the masking and, you know, the types of mask and should you be in this? Look, we're going to learn. And I think if we're all in cloth-based masks, we're all fine, right? I mean, we're going to be good. That cloth-based mask is going to prevent me from coughing all over Rachel and getting her sick. Her cloth-based mask can prevent me, and we're going to have that. We're going to say the nurses are going to be in surgical masks likely. And that's going to be because they're going to be dealing probably with people that are really, really sick. You all can be in that cloth-based mask and have that. You can have the cloth-based mask and a face shield if you have more comfort with that. That's fine. The data on face shields is still emerging, though, and the CDC says, look, we don't know, but it seems to be beneficial. So, sorry, long-winded ID answer for a simple question, but I think you guys will really come up with some cool things that they can do even when it gets a little harder in the wintertime. And I will say lastly, I have a buddy in Utah. They're like, we're just doing everything outside. I don't care if it's cold or not. They can do it. I'm like, okay. I mean, all right. I mean, that's what they do. So.
All right. Thank you so much to our doctors, Rachel and Jason. We may have a few more questions. I know we still have some time. So if you have some questions that arise between now and 11, feel free to drop it in the chat. But we did want to pause and just share a few resources with you. Let me share my screen so that you can see this. Christine's going to be dropping a link to this document in the chat for you. And this is meant to be a collaborative document. It does a couple of things. The link to the slide deck is here for you with all of the information. We will also put a link to the recording. Once the recording is ready, we'll drop that into this for you. We've got Laura and Sean's contact information, and they are from the Missouri Department of Education, so you can reach them there. These blank boxes are for you. If you would like to include your information, if you have some resources to share, once you have access to this link, this is a shared document, feel free to add any links here that you think might be helpful to the group. We had about 200, a little over 200 folks actually present today, but just know that we have 400 people register and we will share this with all 400 as well. So this could end up to be a really helpful collaborative document. That's our hope. One of the things we'd like you to put in there that we think would be helpful is where you are in the process, whether it's your building or your classroom or your district. And we have a reentry rubric here for you to help help you think about that. Where are you? Are you at the stage where you have a plan and you're willing to share that plan with others? Or are you at the stage where you're just starting to think about this in this nitty gritty way and you would really like some input from others? So you can share your contact information and any resources by dropping them in a cell. And if we run out of spaces, feel free to add more. You simply click in an empty box and hit the tab key and it adds more cells. I think most people are really familiar with how to use Google. All right, and then down below that in this shared document, we do have a link to a survey. We'd like your feedback. This is really important for our work because with DESE, we are working on designing more of these kind of statewide PLNs, professional learning networks, and we need to know your ideas for topics. What topics do you think are top of mind right now? And then Christine also dropped the link to the vendors. She mentioned that in our chat box here. And so you can see which vendors have the supplies that you've been asking about. Thought that might be helpful. So just want you to know that you have access to all of this. If you don't do anything else, the one thing that we would really like you to do before you log out today, because we know once you log out, it's not likely you're going to come back and do it. So before you log out today, if you would click on the survey and take the survey for us. Just a few questions really quick, and that's gonna go to Laura and Sean at DESE to help them make some decisions about next steps. All right, that said, any other questions, Sean or Emily or Dion, that you see that we haven't addressed?
No, I think mostly we've addressed what's been asked. There's a lot of kind of repeated, and a lot of the questions have to do with just managing your own risk, you know, managing risk. And I think the information we've gotten today really helps us to think about that.
There is one unique one that stood out, and it's about special education classes.
Yeah. I didn't see, do you have it, Sean?
I'm going through it right now. I saw it earlier. I didn't save it though for myself.
I think that's a really important point. I think the special education individuals, we know that intellectual disability and developmental delay children have had a pretty significant impact, even greater than our regular students when it comes to COVID. They've had some greater risk of disease and do provide some other unique challenges as we work with them. I think that in these settings, we are going to have to be even more innovative, especially for like the caregivers who work specifically with those who have a little bit more needs and might have more secretions and those sorts of things. And so if you're one of those individuals, I would say, hey, what kind of personal protective equipment might we have for you that's a little bit above and beyond what you do in the normal classroom? So is it a regular surgical mask? You know, gloves and those sorts of things will be necessary. We need to do something. I mean, these kids are losing greater. We've heard from parents as we're working with our special school district here in St. Louis in developing some things for them that, you know, they need their services beyond just the education, the physical therapy, the occupational therapy, and many of them in their mental health and those outbreaks that they're having is even greater. So I encourage you all to continue to think about those and discuss how we might serve those children as well. And it's a super big challenge that is all in front of us beyond just this enormous challenge which we're already facing. Another non-answer to with an answer.
Rachel, did you want to add anything to that?
No, I agree with Jason on that. Really important to include these students in, you know, with all their needs in all our activities. And so just strategizing about the best way, it's really critical.
All right, thank you. Before I turn it back over to Laura and Sean to kind of close us out, I want to bring up something. It was on the news this morning. I actually saw it on social media and then I saw it on the news, and it was an NBC report where they asked five pediatricians who all had children of their own, if they would send their kids to school, if they would be sending their kids back to school in the fall. I won't tell you what they said, but I'm curious if you wouldn't mind sharing with our audience what you would say to that.
Rachel,
Absolutely. I am absolutely sending my kids back to school in the fall. And it's not like I don't worry about things. I worry about the flu every year for my kids. And I'm, you know, in line first to get the flu shot for them. So I certainly don't want them to become ill. And I certainly don't want them to be exposed. But I am absolutely ready for them to go back to school.
Yeah, Rachel and I have worked with those individuals on that were interviewed on that NBC story. And, I think we all definitely feel that they can go back to school. But I think we also have realized as we've gone through this process, and Rachel and I have talked about that this just this morning, and as was mentioned earlier, is that we know we need to partner more with the educators. All of you who you know, when you have 450 people sign up for a webinar and over 200 show up on a Monday morning, we know this is concerning to you all, and know that we want to be a part of it with you. We, in our field, and we, as we walk around the hospital and care for patients and around these people, we feel we can do this safely and have our children be with you and that you would be safe. And just know that. And I think, yeah, I'm all in. But it's going to be challenging, and we're going to learn a lot, but we're going to be better in the end for sure after this is all done.
Thank you. So it's unanimous because all five on the show this morning all also said that they would send their children to school. So it's unanimous with that. Thank you. Laura, we have just about 5 minutes left. I want to turn it over to you and Sean for any final thoughts or any directions.
Yes, if you wouldn't mind going back to the resource slide so I can share that as a follow-up.
Hey, Sherry, real quick while you're in transition there, the Google Doc people need access to the Google Doc.
Sherry's working on making that happen now.
Thank you.
So Sherry has, of course, this slide deck is available to you, but there are several resources that Missouri has already provided for you. The MSBA pandemic recovery considerations were out a while ago, back in April. Since then, National Shape America School Reentry Considerations have been posted. There is the National Federation of High School Athletics posted. Obviously, we've mentioned the EPA lists of disinfectants, and Jason has provided the resocialization of sports in the St. Louis area on this committee, the work that they're doing. And just recently posted last week are some frequently asked questions about school reopening health guidance that have sort of come out. You know, we're getting more and more questions from different stakeholders in the school environment, whether it be central office, teachers, physical education staff and coaches, that are and nurses, school nurses, really wanting to get into the weeds of the information, and that we're hoping that this has provided you some more details. So please visit those, because there will be more information posted that really gets us into more depth, just like this webinar has provided for us. Keep in mind that information is ever evolving, so there are new things that are posted frequently, and the considerations from MSBA may be updated at any time based on the new information. So before my final comments is that I do hope this information has been very helpful. We do want to keep this conversation going, and through the Google document and the survey, you will help us to provide more information that we can begin to deliver sessions to address the most highest needs that we're hearing. I do want to say thank you to the facilitators of this session, because they've done a great job in their efforts behind the scenes and keeping things moving forward. And a huge thank you to our panelists, Rachel and Jason, for providing their expertise and allowing us to utilize their expertise to help us address some of the most common questions that we're hearing from the field. We'll continue our conversations across the Missouri, the state of Missouri, and we will continue working with Rachel and Jason to get more up-to-date information as we move forward toward the new school year. So I want to thank everyone for being a part of this webinar and the participants as well. Hope you find this information helpful. But a big thank you to all. We're all in this together. You have any final words, Sean?
No, Laura, you said it all. Thank you all for just taking part in this. And, you know, particularly my health and physical educators out there, feel free to reach out to me directly. Because I know and I understand our circumstances are unique in this time. So any questions or concerns you have, just reach me directly.
And our contact information is being provided. Plus, as we move forward, the information from these sessions will be posted on the Mo Healthy Kids website. So we have a mohealthykids.com website where we will post that information. We'll also host it on our DESE web pages, as well as host it on social media. So you will have that information accessible.
All right. Thank you, everyone. Have a great day. I think we're ending right on time. It's 11 o'clock, I believe. So. Thank you all for attending.
Thank you so much. Have a great, safe rest of the day and year. Guys.